in this service. Kenneth Donald Lindback left us Wednesday, June the 6th. He was and I love this obit, he was a great laugh and an awesome teacher. His confidence was outstanding. His perseverance was an encouragement to many that knew him. He was the son of Carl and Ein Lindback. Stepmother was Ayla. He was a father to Mika and Daniel, whose wife is Kirsten, brother to Ava Kaliome, Vicky McGrain, Harry Lindback, wife Donna, Dave Lindback, wife Sandra, and Marlene Rivet, husband Ron, Maylee Lewis, stepbrothers Brian Lindback and the late Rainer Hutala. And he certainly loved his past brother-in-laws, Calervo Calume and Harold Dub McGrain and Tim Allen. He was a grandfather to Sarah, Kaylee, and Cashton, and an uncle and a great uncle to many. There's a wideness in God's mercy. There's a wideness in his mercy. It's like the wideness of the sea. There's a kindness in his justice, which is more than liberty. There's a welcome for the sinner and more graces for the good. There is mercy with the Savior. There is healing in his blood. For the love of God is broader than the measure of man's mind. And the heart of the eternal is most wonderfully kind. If our love were but more simple, we should take him at his word, and our lives would be filled with sunshine in the sweetness of the Lord. So as we gather today, our hope is that we would glorify the Lord Jesus Christ and that we would honor Ken's memory among us. Let's pray together. Father, it's in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ that we gather today. Thank you, Father, for the privilege that we have to approach that throne because of him. And as we seek your presence, Father, we seek your peace. I pray for your peace for the family, for Mika and Daniel and each one of his sisters and brothers and all of the extended family. We pray, Father, that your presence be felt and your peace realized as we gather in that precious name of the Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. We're going to have some special music now from Marlene and Ron Rive.
And everybody else gets to sing too.
I've got a mansion just over the hilltop in that bright land where we'll never grow old. And someday yonder we'll never more wander but walk the streets that are pure as gold. I've got a over the hilltop in that bright
As I was playing the guitar, I was just thinking about Kenny, how he was the first one that wanted a guitar to play. And then my brother Harry took it to Montos and learned to play. And then Davey took it. And then I think Kenny only got to play a few chords. We're gonna do one more song, but I want to say some things first. When I first heard that Kenny passed away, I was actually kind of in shock because he wasn't sick, and I just saw him and he was Kenny, and I thought I heard wrong and called my sister confirm, because this sister always knows everything. And then the second time, and then the second thing I thought about was that, well, Kenny's running now. No more crutches. And we all know, like, what a character and personality Kenny was. AKA Black Finn, Sticks, Pegs, Crash. Growing up, we never treated Kenny differently. My brothers and Kenny's friends, they would take Kenny everywhere they would go. It was nothing for the boys to throw Kenny on a crossbar of an old bicycle and he holding his pegs and taking off with the boys, doing what boys do. And he always hung around Dad, and he hung around with the guys when they worked on their cars. Kenny knew a lot. Couldn't get under there a lot, but he sure could tell you what to do and get fixed. And we always bragged that Kenny had a gift for gab. Man, he could talk. One thing I really do admire about Kenny is what was said earlier, that, you know, Kenny didn't let his disability hold him back. He was very adventurous. He did a lot of things, you know, starting off with the bikes with the kids. And then later on, he graduated to a garden tractor that he'd cut grass and do driveways in the wintertime. And my dad helped build a nice cab for him so he wouldn't be cold. And then he graduated to a car. But he did okay. But before he graduated to the car, like, he got crashed by crashing the garden tractor and breaking his nose and breaking his jaw. All these things. And the one thing that I really remember about Kenny and that garden tractor was, I don't know how he got it, but he had a CB in there so he could, not cell phones, people, a CB. Do you remember what that is? And Kenny would communicate with everybody, and he got the Mac logo, that bulldog, and his handle was Mini Mac. I'm sure all of us have a lot of stories about Kenny, and I know that a lot of you have been a part of Kenny's life at different stages of his life. And I know one thing that he was very proud of, and he never thought he would have a family, but he was very proud of Mika and Daniel and very happy that he could have boys. Another thing growing up too, Kenny, at that time, Kenny was the hardest person to get money from. And Kenny would be the last person you would ask for money, because it was like signing your life away. And then when he got the car and you tried to get, you know, oh, I'll clean your car for some money, well, he would stand there on guard making sure we didn't take the change, eh, Miley's? And then he'd pay us with that change we found. I was just like, oh man, he was cheap. I know there's a lot of stories out there, and I know other people will be saying stuff later, but I just wanted to get my 2 cents worth there, and that, you know, Kenny did really amaze me being in that wheelchair. I don't know if it was me in that wheelchair or on those crutches, I'd have the same attitude as he had. And I never heard him complain about it. He just did what he did. We're going to finish with this song. It's called Refreshing Time, Times of Refreshing. And funerals are an end to our physical life, but Kenny is in glory, and he is well, and he's running around. And I give kudos to the pastor trying to say all those Finnish names. I'm glad Tim had an easy name, Tim Allen. But I'm sure they're shooting the breeze now, too.
I'm just going to remember his smile, that big smile. We always used to joke around and remember Kenny's big smile there. That's what I'm going to remember.
Well, I thank you, Lord, that you are my Savior. You're my strength and you're the rock on which I stand. You give me life and a grace that is greater. When I humble myself beneath your mighty hand, you bring times of refreshing. You bring times of refreshing. You bring times of refreshing to my soul. When I'm weary from the fight and I'm trying to do what's right, you bring times of refreshing to my soul. For the day will come when we'll all be gathered and the sun will rise with healing in its ways. And all the years of pain, they won't seem to matter when our eyes behold our teacher and our King. You bring times of refreshing. You bring times of refreshing. You bring times of refreshing to my soul. When I'm weary from the fight and I'm trying to do what's right, you bring times of refreshing to my soul. You bring times of refreshing. You bring times of refreshing. You bring times of refreshing to my soul. When I'm weary from the fight and I'm trying to do what's right, you bring times of refreshing to my soul.
That's what the word means. To give well words about the person that we're remembering. So we're going to have a eulogy time right now, and I want to invite anyone that would like to come up and share. But first of all, I'm going to ask Jim Snell if he'll come up. I asked a couple of people to share from a different perspective, who knew Kenny from a different perspective, and certainly Jim was one who knew him. And again, after Jim and then Bob Ackert come, we'll open it up to anyone that would like to share. Yeah. No.
Thank you, Pastor Bill. Mika and Daniel, thank you for giving me the opportunity to share. only knew Kenny for about 8 years. We came up 9 years ago from Toronto, and a couple months after, I was in Canadian Tire in the trailer parts section. And I'm looking for a lens, replacement lens for my trailer. And all of a sudden, there's this voice behind me. What are you looking for? And you could just hear his voice, right? And I said, well, actually, I'm looking for a trailer lens. You know, it broke. He says, ah, he says, they don't sell them here. You have to buy the whole set and put the whole new thing on. Tell you what, just put that red T-tape on and you're done. It's good. And I was like, well, thank you very much. What's your name? And I said, Kenny Lindback. Didn't have consulting service by yet. And so that's how I met Kenny, but I didn't really know anything about him. And then we were attending church here. This is our home church. And we looked one day in the back, and there was Kenny. And then I found out he was a believer, and, you know, it was sort of a good time. So because our son Andrew, who's in a wheelchair user, we found a common interest, wheelchairs. And the good and the bad and the ugly parts of having to be dependent on one. And at that time, I think Kenny was a double user of crutches and then wheelchairs. And so we got to share a little bit on that level. So between myself and Bob, we'll be sharing next, Bob Ackert, who we were called upon to do emergency pickups, repairs, or modifications. Bob was the engineer and machinist who came up with numerous repairs and devices to assist Kenny. I was more like the OnStar contact for roadside assistance because I had the accessible van and spare parts and tools. And there was more than once that I was on the road. Kenny would arrive at our house and do the circuit around the back of our house, looking in the windows to see if we were there, or call us on his cell phone to see if we were in if he couldn't get around the back. I got to know him better during those drop-in repair visits. And as Marlene talked about the gift of the gab, as he always had stories to share about his life, how his life was going, and he would get especially animated about the cars he used to have and was going to have. And I had a lot of wheelchair parts to share with him and that to keep him mobile, and on more than one occasion, his carrying bag that he had on the back of his chair was more than full, and he'd go home with tires and parts for his chairs, and I had no idea. Mika, you guys know what his apartment was like in his workshop there, so some of that stuff was my fault. Kenny was an entrepreneur. Now, some of you, I'm sure, got involved in business deals with him. And Marlene, I don't know if he paid people, but we'll find During these repair visits, he started talking about the idea of starting a wheelchair CAA service to come to the rescue of anyone needing roadside assistance. I know that he put considerable thought into how that would work, and part of his business plan included me. Using our van with the lift to pick up stranded wheelchair users. I encouraged him in the idea, but had to abstain from participation because of my work. And how many of you remember his recent swivel coffee cup holders that he had imported and he was trying to hawk at various places? Anybody who would buy one, he would sell it. And he was trying to target wheelchair users and sports people on ATVs. And those of you that did other things with them, it was always an interesting time figuring out deals. Kenny was a frequent traveler with us in our van to and from church, especially during inclement weather. So we lived right up on the other side of Second Line, and he was on the other side, so we'd pick him up and make our way down here. But this wasn't always the case, as some can testify, seeing him coming down or going up the hill, this hill, on snowy conditions and some severe. And Daniel, you posted a picture. Was that near your place? Queen Street. Okay, so take a look on Facebook where Daniel's post is, or the picture is out in the back. Here he is. He's got his snowmobile hat on. He's decked out in a big parka, and he's just going through the snow, crutches sticking up in the back. And I'll never forget that picture. I said to him, I would ask him why he traveled on the roads rather than the sidewalks. Now, you know, I'm very conscious, got a son in a wheelchair, and I stay on the sidewalks, don't be going in the middle of the road. That wasn't Kenny's modus operandi. And his response was, the sidewalks are either not cleared or too bumpy or too dangerous at the corners. Anyways, if I get hit on the road, I know where I'm going. And he repeated that often. Kenny reflected many of the qualities that we have seen in the lives of others who have faced lifelong disabilities. When God brought us into the world of those with special needs through our daughter and son who were survivors of a traumatic brain injury, we began to see people like Kenny through different lenses and learn to be more understanding and helpful. Number one, he had an independent spirit, and you've referred that already. As much as possible, most special needs people want and seek to be independent and self-sufficient. Kenny was very much that way, very much that way. He stubbornly and courageously fought to retain his independence and self-sufficiency, whether that was dressing himself, doing his banking, shopping, cooking, fixing things, just plain living like the rest of us. And you know, I would say, Kenny, have you ever thought of like getting a caregiver to help you out, or maybe a different living situation? Absolutely not. All right. On the other hand, he was not averse to asking for help when he needed it. Whenever he asked for help to get his shoes on, tie his tie. That's how I could tie mine, because I had to tie his. I could remember. help dress him, bend his knees or his ankles, or position him better in his chair. I considered it a privilege to help him. And just because of that background with our own kids, you know, it gives you a different perspective on these people. Kenny was a big dreamer. And over the short time that I knew him, I don't know how many cars he dreamed of fixing up and modifying with hand controls so he would be able to go whenever, wherever he wanted. In recent years, I talked to Harry a little bit before. In recent years, he talked about getting a small motorhome and traveling across Canada out to BC, where his brothers Harry and Davey live. I used to smile and ask him, how are you going to put this all together, Kenny? And Kenny, with his eternal optimism, said, I'll come up with the buckaroos, and I have contacts. Okay. Even when I spoke to him about a month ago, he had dreams for a better housing situation and chair modifications. Brand new chair, and he was already into modifying that chair. Dreaming and imagining are God-given gifts, and Kenny made full use of them. He expressed frustration. We'd pick him up some Sunday mornings, and a cloud would be over his head, and he would bring it down the hill with us as he talked about something that was really ticking him off. And we heard about the various services that were not meeting his needs, and he was dependent upon those. As we walked down a number of those roads ourselves, we were able to empathize and sometimes assuage his anger or frustrations. What was very interesting, you know, you'd come to church, and you'd enter in the worship and the preaching of God's word, and we'd get back in the van and go home, that cloud was gone. He enjoyed the fellowship here, and God ministered to him while he was here. One of the great joys that he talked about and cherished was that of being a papa. And he had three grandchildren, I guess. He often mentioned how much he adored his grandchildren. And every time he said he's going over to the house, I'm going over to see the grandchildren. It was cool. Kenny was a sleeper. Now, there's different ways of saying a sleeper, but I think you know what we mean by a sleeper. Some of us can picture in our mind's occasion when he would be participating in a meeting, sitting in the back of the church, singing in a Christmas cantata even, or engrossed in a conversation after having a big Sunday meal, when you would see Kenny with his head bowed, or be interrupted by his meditative deep breathing or snoring. He had the ability to fall asleep on demand, then wake up and carry on like, oh, what's going on? It was amazing. What a gift. I recently came across this quotation. God is far less concerned about our behavior than what we think he is. He is much more concerned about our hearts than we'll ever know. And I've been thinking, well, is that right? He knows our hearts. He knows what's going on. Kenny showed that he had a heart for God. When he was younger, older, and I've only known him for a couple of years, 8 years. As you said, physical limitations did not slow him down, did not limit his desire to know and follow God. Yes, he had his ups and downs and wanderings, but he knew Jesus was his hope for eternal life and for others with whom he had contact. In the good times, Kenny was an evangelist, and he shared Jesus Christ. And I saw in him during those times the desire to commune with God and to fellowship with God's people, whether it was here at the church, in a small group setting, in a men's prayer meeting, or at a men's retreat. Kenny was not afraid to talk about the Lord or to share how God was working in his life. That willingness to speak freely about Jesus challenged me. Kenny, like many of us in this room, was on a journey with his Savior, the Lord Jesus Christ. He has now reached his destination and rest, but he left a mark in this world and in our lives that will not soon be erased from our hearts and minds. Thank you.
Thanks, Jim. We'll call on Bob Ackert, the engineer on staff of Kenny's enterprise.
Marlene and Jim, you're a hard act to follow. We all knew and loved Ken. He was a character, and he was a friend. And I first met Ken back in Riverside Bible Chapel, and then for a few years we went different paths, and then Ken started coming here to Bethel Bible Chapel. And Ken somewhere heard that I had a machine shop. I do have a machine shop. He needed his wheelchair fixed. And he would toodle on that wheelchair all the way from his place, up Carroll Place, all the way down the trail. And I live in the east end of Sault Ste. Marie. Some days I'd go up and pick up Ken. We'd go out and have a coffee, have a good time. But we had the best times in the machine shop, because Ken was not only determined, the determination that I've never met anybody else, that he was not going to let his physical disabilities dictate who he was. He wasn't blind to them, obviously. And it's been said here before, Marlene said it, never heard Ken once complain about his physical disabilities. I have never heard Ken complain about hurting. And I know sometimes he did hurt, but he never complained. I asked him about that one time. And he says, well, some things you've got to suck up and live with it, because that's reality of life, and it's not going to define who I am. But he had come down to my shop, and we'd have a good visit in a shop. Well, building a crutch rack for his wheelchair. Need a part? He was the best scrounger I have ever met. He probably scrounged from almost everybody in this room some way, one way or another. But he was one of those lovable scroungers. You loved him. And he'd bring down some old part, and we'd put it in the lathe or the milling machine, and we'd make it into a new part. You know, Ken was a mechanical genius, and I mean that seriously. He'd have stuff figured out. He wasn't such a good financial genius, though. Talking about some of these schemes, some of the things he wanted to do. Sometimes I had to be the Scrooge and said, Ken, you can't afford another car. By the time you buy a car, pay maintenance, pay insurance, and all the rest of that, didn't stop Kenny. Next time he came down to my shop after discouraging him from buying another car, he had a whole pile of parts for hand controls. Bob, it won't fit in my new car. So he had it all figured out, and we took those old parts and we re-machined them, re-welded them, put them back together just the way he'd planned it, and they worked. And I really liked working with him. Linda and I had him over at the house for supper a couple of times. Well, after having him in the house once, we never did that again. Nothing against Ken, but our house was built in 1972 before architects and house designers had any thought of that somebody might be in a wheelchair, so it's a really inconvenient. And if you know my wife, Linda, my wife has physical problems of her own. She's with her hips and her back. We planned for Ken to come over, and we'd have something to eat out in the patio. There's one of these pictures up here. I saw it. I really laughed when I looked. Ken liked eating. Oh, he liked eating. And he didn't get fat, and that sort of made me envious. I like eating too, but it goes right around my waist. But we'd have a good time. And we'd talk about some of these business things he wanted to get involved in. And some of them are more practical than others. The one I think I would have liked to see him go further with is this helping design entranceways to houses for handicapped people. I've done some study in that as an engineer, and you know, very few of them are done well. And I'll say something else. Is there any wheelchair designers in this room? Good, I don't have to worry about offending them. Wheelchair designers should have hired Kent, because he knew how to design wheelchairs. And not only for Ken, for Andrew's chair, and my granddaughter's in a wheelchair as well, my little Rachel. And I have some very bad thoughts for people who design wheelchairs. They're not designed by the people who basically live their lives in them. But Ken would bring that wheelchair over, and he'd have some improvement to it. The crutch rack out back, we made that for the wheelchair. We carried so much junk with them all the time, we built a trailer hitch for it. He was also known in every machine shop in town, Roban Steel, Riker's Machine Shop, and I don't know wherever else. Everybody knew Ken. And he knew more people around the town, and he didn't. He'd be driving somewhere, and there's, you see, Ken over there. He drives somewhere else, there's Ken over there. He never stopped. But in my workshop, there is a sign up that says, by grace you have been saved through faith, and that not of yourselves, it is a gift of God. Not of works, lest anyone should boast. And Ken knew that. He knew that he didn't mind working hard, but he knew his salvation wasn't based on hard work. His salvation was based on faith. And that faith didn't come from himself. That faith came from God. And it's been said that Ken can get frustrated at times. And well, yeah, he would get frustrated at times. But he'd know his Savior was there for him. And as Jim has already alluded to, I'm looking down at his sons here. He loved you boys. And you know something? You frustrated him some days. And you know why you frustrated him? Because he loved you. He loved you right to the end. And the grandchildren. He had a very great love. But for me, Ken was a friend. And I genuinely enjoyed him. He gave him that smile. Whoever put that picture, that's Ken. That smile. It just catches what he is, what's as a person. And usually, if he was frustrated with something, he'd come over to the shop and we'd talk out about something, whether it's a small problem or the world's problem. We'd solve the world's problem. The trouble is, we couldn't get anybody to listen to us. But his determination, he never gave up. He would go and go, and he would need some little thing. And he'd come with, Bob, I need something to do this. And he says, well, what about this? What about that? Well, we came up with some simple little things that help him. Something looked like a cane that he could reach the other side of the bed with and pull himself onto the bed. We don't think about that. People that are not handicapped don't think about those little things. And did you notice the sit skis? Ken one day said, Bob, I'm a Finlander. Finlander's got a ski. So we got together and we ended up building them two sit skis. And Darren, who's at the back of the sound station right back there, Darren took him out skiing. And he was so happy because he could move. He had some learning to do. I don't think he ever got really good at the sit ski. Darren can tell. Did he ever get good at it, Darren?
Not better.
He got better. Okay. But Kenny's left us for a better place. As Gerald Fowler said when he announced to our chapel family that Ken had passed on, he left his wheelchair behind and he's in heaven dancing. And that's what I want you to take away. First of all, Ken knew he could not work for his salvation. As independent as he wanted to be, he could not work and earn that for himself. He had to accept that as a gift from God. And that's what he would ask everyone in this room to do if you've not already done that. And with that, I'm going to turn you back over.
Thanks, Bob. Would anyone else like to come up and share? Daniel.
Good afternoon. I was fine 3 seconds ago. We had a lot of long talks about his disability and how I could always help him get dressed or get outside in the car. Just toss me in, Dan. Just throw me in there. We gotta go. We're gonna have a coffee with John McDonald or somebody down the street, go to their old shop, work on something. We're always out and about together, finding somebody with the spare part he needed or just go shoot the breeze, I should say. He was a big inspiration in my life. Like, thank you again to Bob and the other gentleman there, Mr. Ackert, sharing those good things about him, because his perseverance has really made me into the man I am today. I just want to thank everybody for coming and celebrating his life. Thank you.
Would there be somebody else? Dallas.
I just have to say something about the younger years. There was a time when we were all younger, and I first met Kenny and the Lindback family at Northland Bible Chapel that my mom and dad had started in Goulais. I see a few Goulaigans out here today. I remember Mrs. Lindback bringing in the kids, and yeah, we all grew up together for quite a few years. We all loved each other, fellowshiped together. Mrs. Lindback learned to read, carrying her English Bible in, and learned to read English and learned to speak English coming to church, she told my mom. My mom and Mrs. Lindback became very good friends. And I remember Kenny's perseverance, like, right from the get-go. Like, from the very youngest years, I remember him coming in on crutches, and it was not a handicap-friendly building at all in those days. And I remember the boys carrying him down the stairs, my brother and Rick and Tim. Tim Allen, his brother-in-law, was the one that got me. He just tossed him over like a sack of potatoes over his shoulder. And he and Kenny would just laugh, and he'd come on down. And the sleeper thing, that got me too, Jim, because there was three notorious sleepers in that congregation, all fairly young. And my dad was known for his emphasis at certain points. And so when Dad was preaching away and he'd make a point, you'd see all three sleepers come to life again. So, yeah, I just want to tell you that a lot of years have passed and we've gone different directions and been in different places, but the memories are warm and the love is still there for your family. And yeah, we loved Ken and we knew him and our youth group, we had fun. And we had lots of fun, and he was never not part of it because of his handicap. He was always in everything. And he and Steve were good friends, my brother. And yeah, it was a privilege to know your dad and your brother and your uncle and your friend. He was also our friend, and we love him. We'll miss him.
Andrew, I think you can just take the floor right there. We don't have a ramp to get up. Maybe we'll get Bob to. It's filled.
Hi. I first met Ken when I guess I met him through Dad or whatever. And I was talking to him and stuff, and he was telling me all about this. I am with March of Dimes, and they were asking about camping for people in wheelchairs and whatnot. And so I was talking to Ken, and he was telling me all about this camp up at the Finnish camp or something for the wheelchairs and stuff. And I was so into that. And I was totally telling my worker, Stacy, that we should get on it and do it and whatever. It hasn't happened yet, but Lord works in mysterious ways. And through that, Ken and I developed a relationship, and he just like showed me all about the Sioux and whatever. We went down to what's the park? No, not Bellevue, the one on Second Line. Not Second Line. Yeah, Fort Creek, sorry. And oh man, it was so awesome. Going on the walk and whatever, or wheel. And of course, Dad put a governor on my chair, so I was never as fast as him. I wonder why. Actually, you just made my chair a bit slower. But Kenny was real fun. And a few times I went over to his apartment and he gave me coffee and whatever. I gotta thank him for that. And yeah, and we took him. Where did we take him again, Dad? Down south, southern Ontario. Anyway, that was fun, and because there were no hotels there or whatever, open hotels with vacancy, we went to the States and oh yeah. But Kenny was a good friend, and I'm gonna miss him. And I know you guys definitely will. But I'm glad he is with the Lord. Just like I I said when my sister passed, because she was in a wheelchair and whatever, and I just was like, she is she is enjoying life way, way, way more than she did before on Earth. One, she's not bound by wheelchair, but, and thank God, Kenny's not bound by wheelchair anymore. And number two, it's all about Jesus. And that's who he is serving, and that's who he is right now at his feet. Thank you.
Thank you, Andrew. Do we have someone else?
Well, I wasn't planning on saying anything. I never do at these events. So. But I miss Kenny. I miss him. I shared a room with him for, I don't know, maybe 10 or 11 years of my life. Okay, we slept in the same room, heard all the stories, all the his inventions, things like that. He was inventing from when he was, I guess, you know, a child, okay, from what I believed. There was I came into the Lindback family, I think when I was about 4 or 5, something like that. We went camping. This was, our idea of camping back then was, our dad, he had a pickup truck, and all the kids get piled in the back, and we'd go up to, I think, near Wawa somewhere. I'm not quite sure exactly where it was. So the first time camping with this group of people. Okay, you understand, I just all of a sudden had a family of nine or something like that, whatever it worked out to. And so we were camping, and we all got some pocket knives and knives, so we started throwing them at stumps, okay, you know, like kids do. Then all of a sudden, a big swarm of bees or wasps came out of there, and Kenny was with us. And we all took off running. Kenny was stuck there, he just could not run. But Harry was there, okay. I remember him going back with all those bees, going to grab Kenny, and we all ran into the water, to underneath the water. And I just realized it was part of something back then. I don't know if you guys remember that, but it was something to see him go back for Kenny, because everybody sort of left him, and he was just trying to go through. At the same time, the same event, he had another brother named Davey. He was at the camp, and I was listening, and they were trying to connive something to do about Kenny. So Davey decided we're going to make Kenny walk, and I believe these guys, okay? Okay, so they asked me to go and go get something for them, which I did, and it turned out I went and got a snake, okay? And I go and got that, give it to Kenny. That's what Davey told me to do. And he almost did walk that day, okay? Okay, if anybody knows Kenny and his snakes, you know. But that's what I ended up coming part of, and you know, a lot of his business deals, things like that. I've heard many of them, and you know, if he would have just had half a chance on a lot of these things, okay, he would have been such a successful person all around. He was successful in one way, but he always wanted to be the, you know, a good provider for everybody, I think, and he just tried so hard to do that, and I'm going to miss the guy. Thanks very much, people, for coming. Okay.
I think what we'll do is allow you the opportunity to share those kinds of memories afterwards in the fellowship hall, and I think we'll move along with our service this morning. And I hate to cut anyone off, but I think that for the sake of the ladies in the kitchen, we'll give you that opportunity in a little bit. I wanted to make a couple of remarks today from a verse of scripture in Mark chapter 7, verse 37. It says, "And they were astounded beyond measure, saying, He does all things well." So we've been talking about Kenny and the memories of Kenny, and Kenny was a large personality. He was a huge personality, and I just loved him, and I have some great memories and that as well. But there's a hymn that really kind of fit for me for today, and it's an old hymn. Let me read you some of the words. "In heavenly love abiding, no change my heart shall fear, and safe in such confiding, for nothing changes here. The storm may roar without me, my heart may low be laid, but God is round about me, and can I be dismayed? Wherever he may guide me, no want shall turn me back. My shepherd is beside me, and nothing can I lack. His wisdom ever waking, his sight is never dim. He knows the way he's taking, and I will walk with him." And when Jerry announced Kenny's passing on Sunday morning, and he quoted that phrase from I Can Only Imagine, "Can I dance for you, Jesus?" And I gotta admit, I got a frog in my throat thinking of that. Thinking of Kenny coming face to face with his Savior and not having to worry about those sticks or the wheelchair or how fast he was going to go, because he could dance before the Lord. But that phrase, "he knows the way he's taking," is really the basis of the remarks that I want to make around the fact that he is taking those steps. Because the reality is that God doesn't make mistakes. He doesn't make mistakes, especially of the magnitude that we're dealing with today. He doesn't make mistakes. He does all things well. And we don't always understand his means. We certainly don't understand his methods, but we know that he does all things well. His ways are not our ways. We'll never understand them on this side of glory. But we know, and we can know, that he does all things well. He may allow the winds to blow. He may allow storms to rage in our lives. Sorrows and tears will befall us. Our path may wind through difficulty, darkness. But as for God, his ways are perfect. Kenny knew that. Kenny knew that. He knew that God works together for good to those that love him. And the Bible says our time is in his hands. I came across a quote from A.W. Tozer that I wanted to share. Listen to this. To the child of God, there's no such thing as an accident. He travels an appointed way. Accidents may indeed appear to befall him, and misfortunes may stalk his way, but these evils will be in appearance only, and will seem evils only because we cannot read the secret script of God's hidden providence, and so we cannot discover the ends to which he aims. The man of true faith may live in absolute assurance that his steps are ordered by the Lord. Kenny didn't take steps, but he knew his way was ordered by the Lord. For him, misfortune is outside the bounds of possibility. He cannot be torn from this earth 1 hour ahead of the time that God has appointed, and he cannot be detained 1 moment after God has done with him here. He does all things well. And he asks us, you and I, each one of us, to trust him whether in the sunshine or through the sorrow. He wants us to trust him. And the fact is, when we cannot trace his hand, we can trust his heart. And I think it's a normal thing in an occasion like this to ask the question, why? Why? Well, the fact is, God may not give us that answer today. He probably won't. But I want you to know that he listens and he responds in his time. And he responds in the wisest of ways. Moses asked why. He said, Lord, why have you brought me with this people into this trouble? Gideon asked, why then has all this happened to us? Naomi said, I went out full and the Lord brought me back empty. Why? Nehemiah said, why is the house of God forsaken? Job said, why have you set me as your target? David said, Lord, why do you cast off my soul? Why do you hide your face from me? And Jeremiah asked, why is my pain perpetual and my wound incurable? But the greatest why in the Bible was uttered by the Lord Jesus Christ himself when he said, my God, why have you forsaken me? Sometimes we have to understand that that's the greatest why that was ever asked. It just kind of consumes all the others. And we know the answer to that was the fact that the Lord Jesus took our sins upon him on the cross, and it separated him from the Father. And because Jesus Christ gave himself on the cross, you and I can trust that, as Kenny did, in faith. He wants us to come with a childlike faith, believing in him, trusting in him. And Vance Havner, who's the most quoted man in the 20th century, said this, you never ask why. You never need to, because Calvary covers it all. When before the throne we stand in him complete, all the riddles that puzzle here will fall into place, and we will know in fulfillment what we now believe in faith. All things work together for good. It's in his eternal purpose, and no longer will we have to cry, my God, why? All question marks are going to turn into exclamation marks. And one thing we know for sure, that Kenny's passing doesn't seem nearly as tragic to God as it does to us. You see, to us it's sorrow and it's grief and it's difficulty, but to Kenny right now, it's a promotion. It's a promotion. It's a release from the burdens of earth. It's an early furlough from the battlefield. It's a relocation to a better climate. It's an instant transport to the celestial city. To depart and be with Christ is far better. To be absent from the body is to be present with the Lord. 1 second, 1 millisecond after Kenny closed his eyes for the last time, he was face to face, dancing before his Savior. Kenny has beaten us to heaven. I used to race with Kenny out. Can I say that? Well, we did. We would race out to the stop sign out there, and just for fun. And he's beaten us to heaven. He's beaten me to heaven. But I can assure you that he is more alive today than he was ever here on earth. Because the fact is that God is not the God of the dead. He's the God of the living. And we don't understand all of God's purposes in all of this. We never will. Perhaps we never will, but we do need to know that he does all things well. He does all things well. And we just have to leave it there. We have to trust him. In heavenly love abiding, no change my heart shall fear. And safe in such confiding, for nothing changes here. The storm may roar without me, my heart may low be laid, but God is round about me, and can I be dismayed? I'm going to ask Darren if he'll come now and lead us in that song that I can only imagine, and then I'll close in prayer. Could I ask you to stand and join us in this? You'll find the words on the screen.
I can only imagine When that day comes and I find myself standing in the sun, I can only imagine when all I will do is forever worship you. I can only imagine, yeah, I can only imagine. Surrounded by your glory, what will my heart feel? Will I dance for you, Jesus, or in all you be still? Will I stand in your presence, or to my knees will I fall? Will I sing hallelujah? Will I be able to speak at all? I can only imagine. Yeah, I can only imagine. Surrounded by your glory, what will my heart feel? Will I dance for you, Jesus? Will I stand in your presence? Or to my knees will I fall? Will I sing hallelujah? Will I be able to speak it all? I can only imagine. Yeah, I can only imagine. I can only imagine. Yeah, I can only imagine. I can only imagine. I can only imagine. I can only imagine. When all I will do is forever worship you.
Be seated just for a moment. I want Darren to have the last word.
Well, I was sitting at the computer in the chapel office last night about 1:30, and my fingers were just typing, and I stopped, and there was just too much to say. I met Kenny 20 years ago, and we spent time together, and then sometimes a little bit apart. I watched his boys grow up, and so many things I could say, and everybody could say something about Ken this morning. I guess it's this afternoon. One of the kind of the bonds that we had was that we were both Finnish descent. He knew a lot more Finnish words than I did. I knew huomenta and kiitos and pula. And he could eat more pula than I could. But another bond that, one of the bonds that we had was, and I'm going to ask Joan if she could play clip 2. And you had to have been there watching this guy on the ski trail. He had far more determination than I did. And like he's doing 10 kilometers an hour right there. And there's just one short little stint. We're on the 2 kilometer trail up at Hiawatha, and there's a little bit of a downgrade, not a little bit of a downgrade, it's probably about close to 75 meters, and it drops probably about 15 to 20 feet. Well, Kenny weighed about 160 pounds because I picked him up several times, and that's what he kind of felt like he weighed. And so he's going down this hill, and Daniel's at the bottom with his camera, and he goes, okay, give me a push. And so I give him a push, and it goes down and it turns a little bit. Well, his skis kind of rode up out of the tracks a little bit, and so I was behind him about 6 feet going, well, I hope he stays in those tracks. And then he moved over to the next set of tracks, and then I see a pine tree about this big, and just as it starts to level off a little bit, the front of the skis caught in, and he turned the corner, and as he's slowing down, and I was kind of worried, I knew first aid, but I wasn't sure if I was going to be able to get into that particular type of first aid, perhaps, but as he's slowing down, I can hear him laughing inside of his, he had his helmet on, thank goodness, and laughing inside of his helmet, and Daniel goes, "Oh, I didn't have the record button pushed." So I said, "Okay, Kenny, well, let's just go back up to the top of the hill and let's do that again." And he goes, "No way." He goes, "I may be, I had it written down." He goes, "I'm not stupid." And so those are the times that we got to talk about in the car. And we talked about all kinds of things in the front seat of my car. And talked about fun things, serious things. There was tears at times. And I'm going to miss them. And I know that every time I go to Hiawatha, whether to ride my bike or ski, I'm going to be thinking of them. And that's what I encourage each one of you to remember, those times that you spent with our loved one, Ken, and perhaps other loved ones that you can think of right now that maybe you'd need to wish you were maybe spending a little bit more time with. And I thank you for the opportunity to share some of these little stories and share that song, "I Can Only Imagine." And I know that Ken is standing before the Lord, maybe kneeling before the Lord, and praising and worshiping him to this today. Thank you.
Thank you, Darren. I can well remember many times Darren picking Kenny up and putting him on his back and carrying him. And that's what family does. That's what friends do. The poet said that friends and family are like sheltering trees that protect us from the high winds of sorrow, the hot sun of grief, and the cold winter of pain. And so we encourage each of you in that today as we go and make our way back to the fellowship hall and enjoy each other around Kenny's memory. Let me pray. Father, again, we're so mindful that you do all things well. Thank you for the reminder of that. Thank you for these heartfelt memories, and thank you for the gift of memory. And Kenny will live on in that capacity in each one of us. But Lord, I pray that whatever ambivalence we find ourselves in before you today, that we would seek you out and that we would call on you, and to know in full assurance of faith that we have that opportunity to see Kenny again because we've trusted in the finished work of Jesus Christ as Kenny did. And so, Father, I pray for strength, for the family, for peace. I pray, Father, above all, that the memory of Kenny would not only encourage our hearts, but again, encourage each one. In Jesus' name, amen. We'll ask the family to lead, and we'll go into the fellowship.
Love is making music with my friend. I can't wait to was a highwayman. Along the coach roads I did ride, with sword and pistol by my side. Many a young maid lost her baubles to my trade. Many a soldier shed his lifeblood on my blade. The bastards hung me in the spring of 25. But I am still alive.
I was a sailor. I was born upon the tide. With the sea I did abide. I sailed a schooner around the Horn of Mexico. I went aloft to furl the mainsail in a blow. And when the yards broke off, they said that I got killed. But I'm living still. I was a dam builder across a river deep and wide, where steel and water did collide. A place called Boulder on the Wild Colorado. I slipped and fell into the wet concrete below. They buried me in that gray tomb that knows no sound. But I'm still around. I'll always be around, around, and around. I fly a starship across the universe divide, and when I reach the other side, I'll find a place to rest my spirit if I can. Perhaps I may become a highwayman again, or I may simply be a single drop of rain. But I will remain. I'll be back again and again and again and again and again and again.
Took legendary and made it liberating. We took safe and made it daring. We took intelligent and made it utterly irresistible. We took the most advanced E-Class ever and made the most exciting E-Class ever. The E-Class Coupe from Mercedes-Benz. The best or nothing.
Amarillo by morning, up from San Antone. Everything that I got is just what I've got on. When that sun is high in that Texas sky, I'll be bucking at the county fair. Amarillo by morning, Amarillo, I'll be there. They took my saddle in Houston, broke my leg in Santa Fe, lost my wife and a girlfriend somewhere along the way. I'll be looking for aid when they pull that gate, and I hope that judge ain't blind. Amarillo by morning, Amarillo's on my mind. Amarillo by morning, up from San Antonio.
Where I come from, there's always salsa on the table. My salsa recipe is actually my mother's salsa recipe, and now it's my turn to pass it on. I'm very proud to be Canadian, but I'm also proud of my culture, so keeping family traditions alive is very important to me. Salsa is sauce. The word literally means sauce, and everybody's got their own recipe. Good salsa needs three things. It's gotta be chunky, which means using the right tomatoes. It's gotta be spicy, which means using the right peppers. And above all else, it's gotta be fresh. And that means growing your own vegetables. This is my grocery store. Fresh organic tomatoes, peppers, onions, garlic, cilantro. I have friends who also use corn, beans, or even fruit in their salsa. But I am a purist. Beefsteak tomatoes are pretty good, but you can't beat Roma. Sweet, firm, not too juicy, which is actually better for sauce. They also have fewer seeds, which makes things easier. You always want to remove the seeds or the pulp waters down your salsa, and nobody wants that. I use a fair bit of salt to draw out the moisture, but absolutely no black pepper. The only pepper in my salsa comes from my garden. I use jalapenos in Ana salsa, but the grown-ups get a full blast of habaneros if I'm feeling adventurous. The only problem is you can't make my mother's recipe without lime, and lime is a tropical fruit. I wouldn't have even thought it was possible to grow them in Canada, but Home Depot showed me how. It took a little effort, but now I grow my own limes. There's a special satisfaction in eating food you grew yourself. It's the taste of home.
Across the blue skies, straight into straight line, you can't get here fast enough. Buy the truck and fire it up, lean on the gas and off the clutch, leave Dallas in the dust. I need you in a rush, so baby run. You ain't got a suitcase, get a box, an old brown paper sack. Pack it light or pack it heavy, take a truck, take a Chevy, baby just come back. There's a shortcut to the highway out of town, why don't you take it? Don't let that speed limit slow you down. Go on and break it. Baby, run. Cut a path across the blue skies. Straight in a straight line, you can't enough. Find a truck and fire it up, lean on the gas and off the clutch, leave Dallas in the dust. I need you in a rush, so baby run.
Enjoy the ride. Introducing the all-new Jetta.
Parts are.
Deep inside, or read between the lines.
it's really no reflection of my youth. Sometimes I feel like Jesse James, still trying to make a name, knowing nothing's gonna change what I am. I was a young troubadour when I wrote in on a song. I'll be an old troubadour when I'm gone. I was a young troubadour when I wrote in on a song. I'll be an old troubadour when I'm gone.
We have been partnering with Canadians like you to help vulnerable children break free from poverty and injustice. Local World Vision staff get together with community leaders and help them assess their greatest needs. Do they need access to clean drinking water, education, healthcare, and nutritious foods? We work with the community so the community can continue to thrive on its own without help in the future. To make sure it's a better place for children to live, grow, and have a brighter future, it's made possible because of generous Canadians like you.
Right there in black and white.
but you can't see with those shades of gray. Keep cover, you should have seen it in color.
We took legendary and made it liberating. We took safe and made it daring. We took intelligent and made it utterly irresistible. We took the most advanced E-Class ever and made the most exciting E-Class ever. The E-Class Coupe from Mercedes-Benz. The best or nothing.